You know, when we talk about live your quest, that's a really big statement. It can be exciting and scary. Anybody have that mutual feeling at times? You're like, live my quest? I'm just trying to figure out my GPS. I'm trying to figure out what does next year look like. You know, and then there's that opportunity that comes with living your quest to go, wait a minute, what happens if I decided and designed my next best season? What would that look like? I wake up in the morning to find out, how can I disrupt anything that's not in alignment with my future today? And so since I'm on the stage today, I thought I'd just do that with you guys as well. Is that all right? Yes. When we talk about living our quest, I think that living my quest, really, if I look at it on a daily basis, it's finding my own voice. It's finding your voice. It's finding the song that only you can sing, off key or not. It's finding your rhythm. It's discovering what it feels like to walk in your shoes today. It won't look like it looked 10 years ago. Living your quest is, what can I do with my life so that my life becomes infectious to someone else? Living my quest looks like, how do I make my fingerprint matter so big that it lives beyond my transition day? Living your quest is, how can I forgive the perceivingly unforgivable so I can love the absolute lovable? Living your quest is, how do I give myself 1,000 second chances, and every time I get to 999, press reset? Yeah, yeah. Living my quest is not some ambiguous, untouchable experience. Living my quest means going back and healing the little girl in me so that the woman can be free. It's going back and embracing the little boy in you so that the man can show up and give himself permission to cry when necessary. Living your quest is not something that you can't touch. It's not something that requires a stage or lights or cameras. Living your quest is being complete and content with who you are in the dark of the night, so who you are in the middle of the day is all right. Living your quest is as simple as it is complex. Living your quest is about giving yourself permission. Say permission. On a daily basis to become the next best version of yourself. Living your quest is not holding yourself hostage to old decisions, not holding yourself hostage to shame, blame, guilt, regret, and anger. Living your quest is about recognizing that every day I can be reborn to my possibility. Yes. Yes. See, living your quest is as internal and personal as it is public. Living your quest is about recognizing that you have brilliance in you and not being willing to dim your light one more day. Living your quest means not being afraid of the genius in you, even though you have doubt. Living your quest is recognizing that you get to sing your song off tune, that you can get to live in perfection while you master imperfection. Living your quest is, it could be complex and it could be simple. And I'm only telling you the things that I've had to do. Because in so many ways, I didn't know I would be standing here with you in Cancun. My path didn't make sense that it would land me here. I look at my life as a young woman in South Central LA, living between the Harlem Crip 30s and the Rolling 60s. Those are not cheerleading squads, y'all. Having three fights a week to get home from school, and that was the easy part. The hard part was the fact that my highest grade in school was a C+. See, when some of you brought home C's, your parents were frustrated. When I brought home a C, my parents were excited because I was severely dyslexic in school. So it took me a lot longer to learn. The last time I took an English class, I got a fail. And my English teacher said, Lisa, you have to be the weakest writer I've ever met in my entire life. I said, does that come with an award? I am kind of collecting rewards. And the last time I took a speech class, my speech teacher gave me a D- and said, quote unquote, Miss Nichols, I recommend that you never speak in public, that you get a desk job. And what it showed me was that some of your best motivation might come wrapped in sandpaper. Some of your best inspiration comes with some pricks and some nails and some thorns around it. Some of your best inspiration came in an experience that you didn't ask for, you didn't want, and you'd never want to have again. Some of your best inspiration, some of the very thing that's fueled your soul to get you here, came in an experience that you dare not wish on your enemy.
I want to talk about doing you unapologetically, no longer dimming your light. You know, this is something that I lived with and in many cases struggled with for years. You know how you can recognize very early on that there's something unique about you. You walk into a room, and what we tend to do when we walk into a room is we measure and recalibrate ourselves based on where the room is to make sure we don't outshine the room. Come on, type in chat, Yana, or yes, that's me, or yes, yes, you see the sign, yes, yes, that's me. If that's been you, I would walk into rooms, even in middle school, even in elementary school, and for sure by the time I got to high school, and I didn't even know that I was doing it. I would unconsciously step into a room and check to see if I can do Lisa, or what percentage of Lisa could I do. I rarely walked into a room and gave them 100% of me because I didn't want to outshine the room. I didn't want to out energy the room. I didn't want to do something. I didn't want to stand out in the room. I just wanted to be accepted. I realized that I wanted to be accepted more than I wanted to do me. Is that you? Have you ever been there? Are you there right now? When I would go to family functions, I would calibrate my energy based on my family members. When I would go to meetings, I calibrate my energy, calibrate my light, adjust my light, turn my light down based on who else was in the room. When I was at a track meet, or when I was in theater or in dance, I would adjust myself to make sure I didn't stand out. I was more committed to fitting in than I was to doing Lisa. You know, does that sound familiar at all? Yana me, let me know. Lisa, you are not alone. And so this episode is about that thing you already know. You are an unrepeatable miracle. No one on this planet can do you. And what my Reverend Dr. Michael Beckwith said, and if you don't do you, you won't be done. Woo! That was delicious when I heard it at my summit. If you don't do you, then you won't be done. There's only one person that can give us you. And you don't give us any benefit. You're not giving us a bonus. When you step into our space and you measure the energy and you tone down your light, you tone down your brilliance, you turn down your beauty so that we won't feel insecure and uncomfortable in your presence, you're not doing anyone a favor. So I'm gonna say to you, sis, I'm gonna say to you, brother, I'm gonna challenge and charge you. When you step into that next room, wherever that room is, whether it's your home, whether it's your business, whether it's a virtual room, whether it's online, whether it's on Zoom, whether it's on Facebook Live, wherever you are, I'm gonna challenge you to give us the best version of you. Because when you let your light shine, you have no idea how your light can become contagious and could lighten up what could have been a dark moment for me. But I need you to shine your light as brightly as you can so that I can pick up a glimmer of who I can become. I'm not gonna try to do you, but I need to be able to see in your light a better version of me, a more solid me.
I stop by to ask, are you willing to play so big that you scare yourself? Are you willing to sing so loudly that the next room stops? Are you willing to dance in such a rhythm that you become contagious? Are you willing to forgive the unforgivable, love the unlovable? Are you willing to do it all 1,000 times until you get it right? Are you willing?
Yes.
Like, I just stop by because that's what it feels like on a daily basis to recommit to the divine assignment on your life. Because your life has less to do with you than it has to do with all of us who will cross your path. And because you let your light shine, you gave us permission to do the same. Because we saw you do it with knees knocking and teeth chattering, but you did it anyway, we just become copycats of you. Well, he did it. I might as well do it. And all of a sudden, an entire nation is doing something bold and outrageous and radical.
If you're in an environment that's negative, and you can't move right now, number one, I would say to Brandon and to Bruno, and anyone else who needs to hear this message, that your now is not your forever. So it's important right now for you to do that thing that I used to always do when I was living in Inglewood, and I love Inglewood, nothing's wrong with Inglewood. I just had a lot of chaos in my life when I lived there. I kept reminding myself what I will recommend that you remind yourself. There is a light at the end of the tunnel, and it's not a train coming at you. It really is light. Now, sometimes the light is glaring and it's big because it's closer.
Right.
And sometimes the light is a just an absolute flicker because it's further off.
Right.
Your job is to know you might not be able to run like an Olympic athlete that fast. You may not be able to trot. Some days you're just doing a walk.
Right.
And some days you might just be doing a crawl. But if you keep putting one foot in front of the other, if you keep doing it, it's not about your speed.
Right.
It's about your consistency. You keep checking into this channel. You keep your hooking your caboose to trains like this, trains like you. Then that one step, you know, I can't remember who said this quote, forgive me. But they say the journey of 10,000 miles starts with one step.
Right.
You know, I think I know who it is, but just because I'm not clear, I won't say it. I won't guess. But you can get 10,000 miles.
Right.
One step at a time. Yeah, it's going to take us a while.
Right.
But you got a while. You're going to get older anyway. Why not use that time taking a step in the right direction? You know, this time in my life is... like, I hear people say surreal, and for years, number one, I didn't know what surreal meant. I guess because I didn't have a lot of surreal moments. I had a lot of real moments, laced with struggle and doubt and questioning. And now I understand surreal. Surreal is when you, for me, I'm living inside my own life experience, blown away by what my life experience is. I'll never forget that my first office was in a walk-in closet that you really couldn't walk in. It was kind of step in and turn. I'll never forget that. I know exactly where it was. I could see the closet in my head or my office. So when I look around and I see the growth, it truly cements that your resiliency and your willpower is greater than any circumstance around you. Like, that's what this tells me. That's when I look around and I see you guys, I see my team. I hear Jelani talk about how he was on a team meeting and each of the team members in my company were reciting a guiding principle and how he could hear me in the guiding principles. But I wasn't there. I was on vacation. That's powerful, because for so long it was lonely. For so long I couldn't have anyone join the journey with me because I was still trying to define what it was. So it just shows me that you can have something in your head, and for a while no one else has to get your vision. I used to get upset because I felt like no one got my vision. Well, no one got my vision because God didn't give my vision to them. God gave my vision to me, and it was my job to birth the vision so that you can show up, Matt, and John can show up, and David and my family can have this experience. And it was exactly the way it was supposed to be. Like, every early morning and every long night, every moment, oh my God, it's been 20 years, and I can't tell you how many times I thought, I'm just about out of business right now. Like, yep, I'm gonna be out of business in 30 days. Like, I had so many 30 days from out of business, 30 minutes from out of business. I have no idea how I'm gonna pay that bill. Just so many of those. And the one common denominator that I could say every time was, I raised my wheel greater than the circumstance. I dug deeper in my resiliency than I was in debt. Like I was in deep debt, but I had deeper resiliency. And so that's why I'm on fire. I'm on fire for teaching people how not to stay standing up, but how to master getting back up, how to master bouncing back, how to then master running and soaring. And so it's, dare I say, surreal. Dare I say, I'm unbelievably true. And I stop asking myself, was I worthy of this? Like I'm at a place where I'm not in an internal battle of the why me, how me. God, are you sure me? For a long time, I was living in an external success, but I had so much internal doubt that I'm the right person for it. I got peace. I look around. I look at the pictures of Nelson Mandela and Martin Luther King. I look at my sisters behind me. I look at the environment and I go, no, I didn't land here. I climbed here. Like I wasn't helicopter landed on this mountaintop. I got the glutes. I got the abs. I got the quads. I got the biceps and the triceps. Though I'm working on them all still, I got the muscle memory that remembers the climb. So I'm at peace with my imperfection. And today I'm at peace with my brilliance. There is no plan B. Just keep tweaking plan A. My past does not equal my future. Your past does not equal your future. Yesterday does not equal today or tomorrow. It's a setup for today or tomorrow. So my mistakes of last month, last year, or 30 minutes ago does not define my next decision. Reinvention is available to everybody every day. Reset, restart, recommit, recharge, redesign it. Like that, re has been my life. Restart it, redesign it, recommit to it, rededicate, go somewhere, recharge, redirect, all of that. Save me 30 minutes away from closing my doors, 30 days away from shutting down my business, 3 months away from quitting it all. And then I'd stop and recommit. I'd redesign the strategy. I'd release the old strategy that wasn't working. I'd ask for help. There's been so many 30 days away from closing the doors, and it's been 20 years.
I'm gonna say something that might disrupt people, but that's who I am. Your ego wants to know about the finish line first. That's ego. And it actually is more selfish than service. So it's saying, if I know where I'm going, and if I know that it's gonna work, and if I like how it's gonna end up, then I'll play full out. What? Do you think Martin Luther King played like that? Do you think Harriet Tubman, Rosa Parks, do you think Oprah played like that? Like these individuals said, I'm gonna play full out. And so when you say, I'm going to do it, I'm willing to live in the unknown, I'm willing to confront the uncomfortable. By the way, the unknown is uncomfortable for all of us. So don't think that I'm backstroking in the unknown and I love it. But you have to be more obedient. You have to be more living in your conviction to be a disruption to the way life is today. And here's what I realize. People want to get clear before they fully get in action. And that's what you're seeing right now. People want to get clear before they fully get in action. Well, guess what? Clarity follows action. So when you get in action, clarity is revealed. So people are waiting. I'm gonna wait till I get clear to play full out. I'm gonna wait till I get clear. And then clarity is going, I'm just gonna wait till you get an action to reveal some more clarity to you. Because clarity isn't revealed from a dump truck. Clarity is revealed in a spoonful. But you have to be in action with the previous spoonful that you received in order to get the next spoonful. So you're trying to see 2,000 miles down the road, and 2,000 miles is waiting for you to take 200 steps. This particular lesson, I'm not just bringing it to you because I know it. I'm bringing it to you because I struggled with it for so long. See, in my world, being disciplined and creating, motivating the masses, it meant grinding every day. Raise your hand, type in chat, if you say, Yana, you are not alone if you are a grinder. Like, I was on the treadmill every morning, not physically, but figuratively. I was on the working, creating, developing Lisa, developing, motivating the masses treadmill every single day. 16, 17 hour days, 7 days a week. I take a little break on Sunday, but I put in at least 5 to 6 hours on Sunday. I put everything aside for the sake of building the dream, building the machine, building the brand, building the message, building, 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 building. And while that's necessary, it's so important for you to have the discipline of consistency, the discipline of putting the units of time in, whether you're doing research and development, whether you're doing practice and operation, whether you're doing debriefing and assessment, whether you're doing implementation, whatever it is you're doing in building your dream, it's important to have the discipline to be consistent in that practice. That's important. Consistency is gonna bring about results. It's gonna give you great results or it's gonna give you great lessons. And either one, you need. However, the area that I lacked in was the area of practicing self-care. Raise your hand if self-care is the muscle that still and atrophy. You know how, if you've seen Popeye, this might date you. If you're old enough to know about Popeye, then we're in the same zone. You know, Popeye would put a muscle up and the muscle would be nice and round, and olive oil would put the muscle up and the muscle would hang from the bottom and just kind of wiggle. Well, my discipline muscle to build the business, to build the dream, was a Popeye muscle. It was solid, not going anywhere. Hold on, was that solid? Okay, yeah. It was solid, it wasn't going anywhere. But my olive oil muscle was the muscle of practicing self-care. So if I'm going to teach you and inspire you to do anything, I'm gonna say, don't do it like I did it. Do it like I learned how to do it. Self-care is as important to your dream as getting on the treadmill of making sales calls, getting on the treadmill of being consistent on social media, getting on the treadmill of knowing your numbers and your projections, getting on the treadmills of mastering your craft. That the act of self-care is just as important. Because realize that what you're doing is not a sprint. You're not building something that's short term. You're building something that's a marathon. You're building a long haul. You want the work you do now to turn around and serve people in the next 20 years, whether you're still at it or not. So self-care is not optional, nor is self-care selfish. Self-care is your responsibility to your future. As you're disciplined enough to learn new techniques, implement new techniques, make sure that you're also disciplined in self-care. Now, let me be clear. Self-care does not mean balance. Balance is a myth and harmony is a must. What do I mean by that? You'll never rest for the same amount of time that you work. If you're a go-getter, if you're like me, if you're a gladiator, a change agent, a mover and shaker, then everything is not equal. But you can learn how to get what you need out of the time that you put into self-care. Self-care is the act of restoring your soul, restoring your cells, restoring your energy. Self-care is not necessarily a practice of something doing. Self-care is also the practice of being. Being present to your family, being present to your friends, taking time out for casual conversations, allowing yourself to do things that just allow your brain to rest.
This is about discovering more of you, who you've always been and who you're becoming. This journey is not about the person sitting beside you or behind you or impressing anyone. This journey is about working to blow your own mind. Yes, yes. Yes, yes. With the way you love the perceivingly unlovable, the way you forgive the perceivingly unforgivable, the way you bounce back, the way you're not worried about not getting knocked down. Please don't do that, because you want to build your muscles. So when you get knocked down, don't sit down. Don't take out real estate and down. Some people get knocked down and they talk about it for the next 10 years. You know you could have got up, right? They're just sitting there. I can do this for a while, by the way. They're just sitting there. It's your bounce back. Because when you bounce back with something you didn't have before. Yes, 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 yes.
So I came here and I'm grateful to be a part of the tribe. I came here to not make it easy for you to sit down, to stir your soul, to stir your love soul, to turn up something, to till a soil in you that says, I am forever transforming in this moment. The woman you've seen before, the man you've seen before, I'm no longer them. I am transformed. That to have you fall in love with yourself in such a way you only give yourself the best version of everything. And everybody. Yes. See, I stopped by to poke you, to prod you, to make it mildly, to moderately, to significantly uncomfortable for you to sit in any form of mediocrity. For you to make sure you don't look at 2020 when you get to 2022 and say, damn, there was more of me to give back there. And I didn't. To make sure you're not keeping score. Keep track, but don't keep score. Make sure that you trust your picker again. Oh, I didn't stop by for rah-rah. I stopped by to call for, to invite out into the universe the very best version of you. I stopped by to ask you, are you willing? Are you willing to do what you've never done before, say what you've never said before, so you can be the man, the woman you've always known yourself to be? Are you willing? Are you willing to tell any part of you that doesn't serve your future, any part of you, know, the procrastination and the worry and the doubt and the am I good enough? Anybody know what I'm talking about? Yes, yes? And the who can I be over there if I've been this person over here? If you're willing to stop and look at all of it and say, I appreciate you. You got me to this point. But in order for me to go further, I'm gonna have to leave you here. Because you limited thinking, you doubtful Debbie, you naysayer, you vision buster, you can't quite fit in my future. I have lives to transform. I have people to inspire. I have children to ignite. I have loves to create. I have so much to do. I can't quite take you with me, but it's been real. We're talking about how to step into your power. How do you step, and more importantly, how do you stay in it? When things around you are turbulent, when things around you are uncertain, and when things around you are constantly changing. Number one, how to step and stay in your power. Understanding the power you have even when you don't feel like you have it. See, power and your strength, your resiliency, your tenacity, it's not determined by the weather outside or the politics or the social movements or the climate or the health conditions. Your power, your resiliency is there. Some days it's active and you're living in your power, you're owning it, you're walking with it, you're walking beside it, you're walking in front of it, it's walking in front of you. Power's everywhere around you. And on other days you have it, but you set it on the shelf. No one took it away from you. I know there are times we may feel powerless, but no one can take your power. No one. You may have to have reserve power. You may have to think about it differently. It may not be an active power, but power is always yours. You're always in the driver's seat of your life. And I'm not saying that excluding that things may happen to you, but I promise you that there's a point when you can slide back into the driver's seat. Number two, when you feel like you've slid out of your power, how do you get back in it? Well, I'm gonna tell you from my experience. Back in 1997, I had gotten into a toxic relationship, and the relationship left me feeling powerless. My partner in that relationship turned emotionally abusive, verbally abusive, and then ultimately physically abusive. And at the end of that relationship, I felt like I'd lost who I was. And as a result of losing who I was just his girlfriend, I was just his fiance, I was just Jelani's mom, I was just this abused woman. I had to go back and remind myself who I am. So whenever you feel as if you've lost your power, really you've lost sight of who you are and who you've always been. So what are the reminders? Number one, take post-it notes
with affirmations and stick post-it notes with affirmations wherever you spend time. So the first place I stuck them was on the bathroom mirror so that while I was brushing my teeth, I looked up and I saw a reminder, because you need reminders to get back in your power. I saw a reminder saying, Lisa, you are built from greatness. Lisa, you're a divine being. Lisa, you're a child of God. Lisa, greatness is your birthright. Lisa, happiness is your birthright. I would look up while I'm brushing my teeth and it was like something was reminding me, like, oh yeah, I forgot that. Oh yeah, I am. In my bedroom headboard, my bed headboard, it said, you only have to accept healthy love. On my headboard, on the back of my front door, was a post-it note that says, you are ready for the world and the world is ready for you. That was 1997. Like, that's how important those affirmations were in getting me back up and getting me back into my power, turning my crawl into a walk and my walk into a run and my run into a soar. And so if you want to get back in your power, begin to read things and write things to remind you of who you've always been. You may not see the evidence now, but it doesn't mean it isn't so. Second thing is to get people that can remind you of who you've been. Get people to pour into your ears, pour into your mind, pour into your soul. I remember I was on stage once and this woman yelled out at the end of my speech, you're an amazing mom. And this particular day, I didn't feel amazing at all. I had been on the road for 11 days and I left Jelani with my mom and I had never been away from him for 11 days. I felt horrible. And so I felt like I was a fraud. So I walked off stage and I called a good friend of mine who's always with Jelani and I. And I said, can you please tell me why you think that I'm a great mom? Because she had told me that I was a great mom many times. I said, can you tell me why you say that? What do you see? And for the next 15 minutes, she was like, I was like, I need evidence. She just gave me evidence of what made me a great mom in her eyes. Sometimes you need to look at yourself through someone else's lenses, because their lens of you is cleaner than your lens of yourself. The third thing I want to remind you is, how do you live in your power? Once you've gotten it and while you're in it, how do you live in it? I'm gonna be honest with you, because I'm your sister. I'm not here to just give you rah-rah hoopla. There are some days when while you're living in your power, it feels as if you're getting further and further away from it. And on those days, remind yourself. And when I say power, I don't mean a dominant power. I don't mean a power that dominates others. I don't mean an egocentric power. I mean a power that keeps you in peace. A power that says, I am in the driver's seat of my life. I'm not a victim of my life. Every now and then it feels like things like COVID or things like, you know, social injustice or things that are just happening around you, unexpected death of a loved one. It feels like it throws you over into the passenger seat and then it throws you into the back seat. And at times it throws you in the trunk. It's your birthright to climb out of the trunk, climb out of the back seat, slide over from the passenger seat and get back into the driver's seat and say, this is my life. I have one thing that I run from beginning to end, and that's my life. And then just like how you get back in your power, the way you stay is you get people in your tribe that are cheerleaders. You get high conscious thinkers. Don't get low conscious thinkers. Low conscious thinkers will always want you to keep them company.
Happiness is one of those conversations that and experiences that can be a bit elusive, because people believe that when they found happiness, that it should stay forever. And the reality is, happiness is one of those ebb and flows. That happiness today will look differently than happiness did 3 years ago. Happiness 3 years from now will look different than the way happiness looks for you today. Happiness is something that expands and contracts. Happiness is something that you bring into a room, not what you search for a room to give to you. What I love about happiness is that it's something that you can carry with you. It's like a light. You know, we have people in our lives, and you may be one, or you may know of someone, where you step into a space and you measure the joy in the room or the light in the room, and then you adjust your light accordingly. Happiness is sort of like that light. Then there are others, like I've learned to be, where you step into a room, and when you step into a room, you actually bring the light in the room. Not that the room wasn't bright before you came, but you carry your own palette. You carry your own storage of happiness, meaning your temperament of joy is set and decided before you interact or engage with anyone. I'd love to share with you some of the tools that I've used to find my happiness. That's one journey. To keep my happiness, that's another journey. And to get back to my happiness, Lord knows that's yet another journey. So some of the things that helps with happiness. Number one, it's understanding the myth about happiness. Someone else cannot make you happy solely and exclusively. They can add to your joy, but it's no one else's responsibility to make you happy than yours. When I realized that in a parent-child relationship, my parents weren't responsible for my happiness. When I realized in a romantic relationship, my partner wasn't responsible for my happiness, that I, Lisa Nichols, I'm responsible for my happiness. And everyone around me, they add to it. In some cases, they might challenge it, but ultimately happiness, my happiness, your happiness is your responsibility. So when you look at the journey to happiness or the journey back to happiness, is there accountability? Meaning, is there someone in your life holding you responsible for the person that you say you want to be? Is there someone in your life holding you as the woman, responsible for the woman you wish to become, for the man you wish to show up as? Accountability is powerful in the space of happiness, because then you always have someone reminding you of your declaration to yourself, and then to the people who come across your path. Second is authenticity. Oh, when I realized how much authenticity and living in my truth had to do with my happiness, and I mean the happiness that's in the dark of the night when no one's looking, that not that happiness in the middle of the day that, yeah, I'm happy. You know that happy that looks more like this? Yeah, I'm happy. How about you? Whereas people are saying they're happy, but on the inside, it's like you're a ticking bomb. It's like you're holding your breath. It's like the smile on your face is for everyone else, and it's not for you. It's that happy that says, I don't trust you to be able to handle my truth, that in this moment, I'm not as happy as I normally am. It's that authenticity that leads to you being able to say what you need to say and do what you need to do to be the man, the woman you've always known yourself to be. It's in not dimming your light because you're worried that someone can't handle your light. It's in showing up and standing as tall as you would stand if no one were looking, standing on your tippy toes, allowing your greatness to enter the room. It's speaking life into the person you're becoming. It's also owning your shadow, owning that dark part of you that you look back at and say, I sure wish you weren't there, but since you're there, I'm gonna deal with you authentically. Happiness lives inside of authenticity. And the third is, can you be honest with those around you? It lives in the same space as authenticity, but the honesty I'm speaking of is the willingness to share with people who they need you to share with them. It's the willingness to tell people who you see. It's the willingness to hold others to their greatness. It's the willingness to remind others when they're not playing as tall, as big as they can, and as they want to be remembered as. Honesty. It's drawing a healthy line in the sand. It's recognizing that if someone keeps crossing your line, it might not be because they're rude or disrespectful. It may be because your line isn't deep enough. It's not bold enough. And can you be honest enough to say, hold on, I've trained you to believe that I can handle everything and that I don't need acknowledgement and that I don't need to hear the word thank you, but hold on, I'm learning something from my coach. I really do need to hear thank you. I really do need a timeout periodically. I really do need my me time. It's being willing to be honest with those around you about how life feels in their presence. Honest enough to say, I love you. I need you. I apologize. I got caught up in my ego.
If you want another awesome video in our Black Excellence series, check out the video right there next to me. I think you'll enjoy it. Continue to believe, and I'll see you there.